Okay, so here we are. I'm hoping to get everybody to present their elevator pitch. Now, we have the elevator pitches from the two people who aren't here, so or the videos, so we'll watch them. But it would be nice to have them here to be able to talk to it. And it looks like I didn't. So this is where we are. But before we get there, I wanted to just look at other stuff. So these are the things that I said from previous iterations of Capstone that I wanted to be able to talk about. There's made an attempt at a mobile app using React Native Capstone. That seemed to go pretty well. Don't use soldering, don't use burst searching. We've had GitHub accounts. I'm going to talk more about GitHub and use of it once we talk to the team. What I asked you to do last time was to take away from you guys at the Arduino and have a bit of a play with it and tell me what you know and miss it and tell me what you don't know. Let's figure out what's worth. What, yeah, so I don't know, Chuck, do you wanna, you've got an app and you're playing with it, do you wanna give us your thoughts first? See if I can bring it up. I think I showed you this before. So this is my younger kid, and they wanted to make an animatronic driver. So this is what one of those is like. It's yours, and it's driving three servos. Server here, and server here, and server here. And obviously the kid doesn't know anything about, so I'm going to stop that from continuing. The kid doesn't know anything about C, but what we do is Google has this thing called Waffle, which allows you to program in Scratch or program graphically and output to any number of formats, including So you just do the first, I think you just type another do, and I haven't done yet, is I want to get, once we've done the down select, I want to think about whether or not basically, you with the PWM stuff, you can output a repeating pulse of a given width, right? So you can set how wide it is. So if you set the width to be that, this one might have an average voltage of here, whereas this one might have an average voltage of here. So because you can change the average voltage. Anyway, so we're still sort of here, but we've started to think about requirements. Part of the reason I've given you the Arduinos is we need to talk about, we will soon need to talk about and I always have a problem with understanding what you mean by algebra. And I did a software guru that I followed on Twitter. And he's, I think he's on Twitter, but one of the definitions of architecture that he uses is what are the key things that make the solution work? Huh? So it's not to do with the colors or the necessarily the shapes, but what are the things you need in the solution to make it work? And it could be that there is a map, it could be that we need a mapper, it could be we need a web server, it could be we need a font other than a mapper, it could be we need to do some 3D printing. There is a 3D printer in the building, and if you ask nicely, I'm pretty sure we'd be able to get access to it, provided you have a good reason, you know, to touch them and use them. But we're not there yet. We've got to figure out what the problem is and how we're going to solve it, which is what this part of the course is about, really. Okay, so we've done the project relevance, and today's piece is the pitch. So that's the project relevance. So they're the things I'm looking for that are need and opportunity, that are transformation of the idea, with our target audience. I've got to come up with the idea, we've got the next steps, and then try to keep our place in mind, got some enthusiasm, and how we're going to test it. That's the thing I'm not going to be able to get to for Kenya and Julia. Okay, so let's go with let's go with Chuck's video first. We saw it, I think we saw it last time, didn't we? The non-blooper reel, there we go. So, I realize this isn't on the group, but something I always think about in this project is unify. Right? You take the target audience and you know, set certain people. So, unify and what we have. So I'm thinking back to my undergraduate, and one of the first labs I ever did was prompt layer, but you have a power supply, and you're given the circuit for the power supply, and you're given a series of these PCB cards. And what you do is you swap a card into the back of the power supply, and it induces a fault in the power supply. And the valve, the job of the valve, is to go through and identify the fault and prepare a piece of kit. And then you can plug up the card and put in another card, and it will induce a different fault. And I think that sort of thing is quite interesting. I don't know about if the product is just like that video is just I think having something physical at Target, I think is a good idea. So last semester, we didn't quite get there. There's a website called, where is it now? There it is. There we go. There's a website called NAND to Tetris. And basically what it does is it takes you all the way through from basic Boolean logic through to sequential logic, through to machine language, through to computer architecture, that then makes the jump from the hardware to the software, incorporated on the sun belt, how to do stack, how to do program control, how to generate a part of the language, how to get the power, and how to make an upgrade. I've used some of this stuff, like some of the mental knowledge of time. It isn't quite there yet, right? What we were trying to do in 466 was try and build a general purpose CPU using the CPU across server and the CPU. And you can these guys have a computer architecture that these guys have followed. you remember Copernicus, right? The problem with Copernicus is it's a new set of plates. Nobody can ever find their way up. Like, it was a big concentric hole. So I think it was a tax something. They decided that they would have a guide robot that they might be interested in. And you could ask it to take you to a particular room like that. And you could follow the robot and it would take you to a particular room. Mm-hmm. So that sort of thing is certainly possible. So these are loads of people who are in the I think you've seen that presentation already in the video. And so I might just take this to the so I have your video and I have English video. See if that makes any sense.
So from my project that I feel would be very beneficial for our people is to be non-linear app. I actually have a loop out here, and I built a small version of this for you, which is carbon, aluminum, a little bit of copper, the carbon fiber, solar, and paper towel. Also, I'm going to be showing you as well in photos because it's kind of hard since I'm recording myself. Now, I've already done this is a 1.5 volt battery, and this non-linear app that I just made is getting off 0.6 volts of power, just for me. Now, this would be, like, my target audience for this would be, you know, people within emergency that need to make a battery quickly with tools in the house. A lot of people use aluminum for cooking. I guess people that have fish tanks have carbon, and then the copper inside is actually, as you can see right here, is for strawberry plants and stuff. You just cut a little piece, you just put it together. Now, this is also used for people that are hiking, you can use carbon house, you know, make, add it to a small form factor battery like this, it'll have a little hole in it, so it'll breathe. Which would be actually my next step in this project, is to put this in a small form factor, you know, so it can eat. Now, the main thought about this was kind of browsing, looking for ideas, and I came across a lithium gear battery because I was amazed by EVs, electric vehicles, and I thought, could we possibly make an EV that can go very far? Because there are EVs that are owned on electric gear batteries, like 2,000 miles on battery, and they just have to be replaced. So what else? There's that, and I feel like, you know, we've been using fossil fuels for way too long, over 100 years, and just like upgrade our system just move away from that. We're in a closed loop right now where to make, let's say, solar panels or computer parts, we need to use petroleum to heat it up and move it around. And so it's important that we start doing that. So we open the loop and start taking out parts of the loop until it's completely replaced by the end, as soon as possible. And that's pretty much our problem. Now, I'm going to provide you guys with some pictures of the battery, which is 1.5, I'll provide, you know, the size of the battery. And then I'll also provide you a picture of the aluminum gear battery created. And I'll show that it's taking out 0.6 volts, just ridiculous. This here is doing that. So that's my project.
Volts. 0.3 volts. It did drop a bit since I originally made it, but nevertheless, it's still pretty cool.
Sometimes in power,
So I like the character. There was a character that was actually, so one thing I like about the world is it's very practical, right?
Yeah.
It's not kind of the human idea, I hope I like to see what happens with the community. But the project aspect of was called Motion Child Life. Right? I mean, the team was starting to provide paths to in rural areas that don't have utility networks. And the idea would be that you walk around and you have the battery charge around, you have to walk around, you have to walk around. The battery charge is up during the day, and at night you take the battery out and you can't get up to where it is like this.
I think I've seen something like that where they use a big heavy, you know, they'll take like a bag or something and put it up really heavy, and then it would be like a pulley system where they would, you know, pull on it, and then the bag would raise up, and then they would slowly come down, and as it slowly comes down, it lights a light bulb.
Yeah, so that's what they eventually developed. So
they got a pretty intensive. They made that in Jackson? Yeah.
So that is the there's the inside of it, right? So you can see the let's see if we can open the original, make it a little bigger. Right, so there's a little bit of electronics there.
Is that a battery? What's this?
Yeah, I think that was kind of cool. And there's a fan. There we go.
And it's a light bulb.
And I got to find the light bulb piece. I think. Yeah, they take the gadget with them, and I've forgotten, I thought they had, I don't know whether these are the most recent ones, but they had a, on one side of this, I think they had the, there it is, there's the LED there. And I've forgotten
and
where the...
So they just walk around with this and charge up?
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah.
What is this called?
It's called the Motion Power
Motion Power Light. That's really cool. I'm gonna take this out.
What kind of ticket? Okay, so.
I mean,
other than just being like, you know, as kind of almost like a rapper, I mean, putting up a lot of very high, just, you know, you feel like you're not playing, like, having a good rapper. I've seen people act really, really kind of awkward with this people, but I don't know if that's a good thing.
No, I don't really know if you want to be a good
rapper. A rapper is corrupt.
So the difficult thing to find when you put out a new one is to find new people's operators if you want to
get them to work with you.
This time, it's really, really hard. So everything is what I call fair happen, including the art of being the collaborative and being the focus of the craft. But it means that because it's real time, it's better to control it in real time. In real hyper system you develop, you get a process of taking up too much CPU. And if you're controlling something that can stop the control, so you better off having a real time system to be not real bad, so that's what I have done. That was another one, but no, the other one, the building didn't sort of move on with some extent. It didn't, you know, but also maybe the one that was used for the
okay, let's. I'll pull up Kenya's video and we'll wait for Chuck to Fez is somewhere here? That's the blueprint.
But that's pretty neat,
so what I'm trying to get my head around is, we've got three really, four really different ideas for both, and you can't communicate. It'd be lovely if we could, but I've generally so much that individual projects don't do a particular thing. So I'm wondering what it is for the moment. And then the question is, do we do marketing with credit in one project, or two things with two? I hope you did two places there, that's quite good. The main thing that both persons say is you tend to get people who get sidetracked. And it's, if you work out it, it does happen, but sometimes things get away from what you need. I remember seeing a team of four, for example, a client, and all four of them were at the front and working. Three of them were on that side and one of them was over there. And it was so clear that there was some, I don't know, disconnect between the one person or the other. It wasn't any, you know, animosity or anything, it was just purely different.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. That one person who you should say anything, didn't have an opinion?
No, they did say something, but it didn't seem to feel good. I think part of it was the one person didn't turn up, and in doing that four person presentation for each person to speak, you've got to talk.
Yeah.
Right? Even just a handle, right? So that you know that this person is talking to this guy, and this person is talking to that guy, and you can try and come up with some sort of I want to work on this. I look through this and start to cover it. It's going to get back with the tie again.
Well, yeah, thanks, guys.
Yep. Let's try to start. There we go.
How often have you been told, call me when you make it home, or text me to let me know you're alright? When alone in an unideal situation, perhaps walking at night to get to your car or your desired location, have you felt unease? Personal safety is something we're all aware of, whether we're consciously thinking about it or not, and the safety of our loved ones or friends are usually quick to follow. Nowadays, ways to assure one's physical well-being range from key rings decked out with pepper spray, flashlights, and alarms, to self-defense classes and non-lethal weapons. However, all entail the subject being in the direct line of danger. But what if there was a way to discreetly notify loved ones or friends of potential emergency situations, as well as contacting emergency services within the press of a button? I am proposing the idea of an emergency app and handheld device that can send text messages to assigned groups of emergency contacts, emit a siren alarm to ward off potential danger, and contact emergency services. Let's call it SafeBit for now. The app portion of this is basically an account that connects to the handheld remote. It'll store the user's personal information, emergency contact numbers, and any information about the recent alerts that were triggered, such as the time, location, and emergency type. The handheld remote is what users utilize to set off those alarms. Think of it as a form of life alert with a few extra precautions that anyone can use. The remote can be used as a keychain or even looped through a lanyard for direct accessibility. The target audience is generally teens and older, people who live alone or are alone often to help maintain their safety. I came up with the idea from personal experience and experiences from others around me. For example, one of my friends was in a predicament where they were followed by an unknown person to and from their job. Their only way of letting myself and others know they were okay was through constant text messages for updates. Of course, with smartphones, getting in contact with anyone is as easy as swiping on a screen, but more often than not, there are situations where you might not have your phone with you, or being on your phone can risk your awareness of the area around you and people around you. The next steps for this project would be to research ways to design this app for compatibility with the handheld remote. Research how to program the remote to achieve the desired results through button activation sequences, and research ways to power the remote without having to charge it via an outlet. Thanks.
Okay. That's pretty good. So,
so you have a remote with a battery. So you need to use
And I might actually try and do it physically this time, now that we're... You may have noticed... this. Right? So...
this is nothing more than the shell statement for... One person types the first one and puts it up on the board. Then somebody else types the next one and decides whether the next one is about the one that is even for or bigger. If it's bigger, you put it somewhere. And then what you end up with is groupings of similar crowd types. And because you are still remote, we did it remotely on using that. And it's still fairly easy. And what we ended up with is a series of things that people were interested in, right? Network protection, media window, power off, or whatever. Perhaps it was a bit easier for me because I think I was
Thank you.
do change the rest of the total failure.
Size of the
Top
is
might be his audio his earlier for his
that's images. Hey, there we go. That's usually all it is. Big coil.
And I think the this user thing is starting to normally you have a variable capacitor.
Yeah.
But I think what they're doing with this is the lead capacitor variable capacitor. It's a variable capacitor.
Yeah, so that's probably a bit too much, but there's your germanium diode there, and there variable capacitors there.
You can see what the voltage plate. stepped onto his next plate, and all of a sudden I hear nothing. And I pulled up because there was a table underneath him at the plate, and I asked if he was getting some food off the plate. Thank you.